So last class, what we studied? We studied how to declare a class, how to once the class is declared, how do you create an object for the class? After that, how do you access the members of the class? The object.member notation. So how do you add a function inside the class? First, the different formats of functions. Some functions will take parameters, some functions will not take parameters.
Sir, screen is not visible.
Screen is not visible. Huh? One second. Okay. Now it's visible, right? Now it's visible, right?
Yeah.
Okay. See, first thing is how to create a class, how to create the object. After that, how do you add functions to the classes? So in that also we have four kinds of functions, with the functions which will take parameter, functions which will not take parameter, functions which will return a value, and functions which will not return a value. The same things which we have seen in C and C++. The same four functions, you can use four kinds of functions or four categories, the four variants of functions. So we studied about these things and how to access the functions. The same thing, object dot the function name. So that is the syntax. If you want to access a variable, object name dot variable. If you want to access a function, object name dot function name. Like this we studied. And also one variant was like, if the function is returning a type, the function is returning a value, you should store that value in a variable of compatible type. If the function is returning a double value, you should store that value inside a variable which belongs to data type double. If the function is returning an integer value, you should store that value inside a variable of integer type. So why this value needs to be stored means for further processing. And also we studied about the methods which will take parameters, the methods which will take a parameter and the methods which will return a value. They are the efficient one, or they are the preferred one, because the generalization can be done by the parameters. By adding the parameters, the functions can be generalized, and by returning a value, that value can be used for further processing. So now then why we are using constructors? So now constructor means it will give some initial value to the objects. Constructor, why we are using constructor means the constructors are used to give initial value to the variables. So when the object is created, the constructor will give the values to the variables. So constructor is having the same name as the class name. If my class name is box, the constructor name will be box only. If my class name is animal, the constructor name will also be animal within the parenthesis, and the constructor will not return any type. So constructor, why we are using constructor? Because the constructor can be used to initialize an object on creating. So you might think that, sir, we are using functions. Sir, we are using functions to initialize an object. So then why do we need constructor? So even though if you are using functions, in the example which we have done. So here we are using the function set dimension. We are using the set dimension function to set the value of width, height, and depth. So here we are using the set dimension function to initialize the value of the instance variable. So it would be you can do in that method also, but if you are using constructor means it will be simple, because the values will be assigned when the object is created. So as soon as you create the object, the value will be initialized. So that's why the constructor will initialize the object immediately upon creating. As soon as you create, you'll get the values for the variables. So constructor will have the same name as the class name, and also it will not return any type. The constructor is not having any return type, like it is not even having void, because it will return, see what constructor will return means that it is a return type of the class itself. It is returning the class itself. So that's why the constructor doesn't have the return type. What is the main job of the constructor? The main job of the constructor is to initialize the objects so that the object will be usable immediately. So now this is my understanding. So this is regarding the constructor. So let us modify the example. So what I will do means I'll just replace the function set dimension with the constructor. So that is the modification which I will do that. So you will get to know how the values will be initialized automatically when the object is created. So what I will do means, yesterday we have seen this function. No. So instead of set dimension, instead of this set dimension, what I will do means I will create a constructor. So how to create a constructor? The constructor will have the same name as the class name. So if I write box, I am creating a constructor, and also I'm not writing any parameters. You know this, if I'm not writing any parameter, I'm referring to the default parameter or the default constructor. So now I'll give the value of width as 5, some 10, some 50, 10, and I'll give it as some 3. So what I did means I just replaced the method with the constructor. So by doing this, what I'm doing is, as soon as I'm creating this object BB, and as soon as I'm creating object B1, so BB will have its initial value of width, height, and depth as 5, 10, 3. And also B1 will also have its width as 5, height as 10, and depth as 3. So how to know that means you can run this program. So if I will run this program, so you can check. One second, I should have saved this. Okay. See, even what I did means I created a constructor called box, and I gave some initial values to the variables of that constructor. So for width I gave as 5, for height I gave as 10, and for depth I gave as 3. So after that, the constructor will default constructor is created. So now as soon as I write this line, the object BB will get its value 5, 10, 3. As soon as the next line is written, the object B1 will get its value 5, 10, and 3. So I'm calling bb.volume. So when I call bb.volume, this function is multiplying 5 into 10 into 3. 5 tens are 50, 50 into 3 will be 150. So for object BB, similarly, the same thing will go for object B1. So what I did, I just replaced the function with constructor. So it is always, but it is better to use constructor when you want to initialize a value. Don't use functions to initialize the value. You use the constructor for that. So now in this example, object BB and object B1. So in this example, object BB and object BB1 were initialized by the box constructor, because you know that both the output of BB and B1 is 150 only, because I'm calling the same volume function. No, so I'm calling the same volume function. So I got the output as 150. If you want to know whether that constructor got executed or not, so how to know that means I'll just write that print statement, so you will get to know about that. So I'll just write constructor block. I'll just write that statement. So if I run this, you will see it in the output also. See, constructor block. Why this is executed means when this line was executed, constructor block was printed, because when this line was executed, the BB got its initial value. And again, the second control block, we got the second constructor got executed when I wrote this line. So if I write only one line, I'm creating only one object. So in that case, the constructor will be called one time. So I'll save this. So when I when this line got executed, the constructor was called. And the value was given. So now, you should see one thing here. So when did I call constructor? Means when I'm creating the object. See, when I'm creating the object, I am writing one line, right? After new, I'm writing box and a parenthesis. So this is the line which is calling me the constructor. So here in new box is calling the box constructor. So now you can understand why we need parenthesis after box. So what it is happening means it is calling the constructor. So in Java, if you're not defining the constructor explicitly, the Java will create the automatic default constructor. Even though you are not creating the default constructor, the Java will create the default constructor for a class. So that's why in the previous version, in the previous examples and all, I was not creating any constructor. Even then, the Java was creating the default constructor, and it will initialize the variables with default values like zero. So in the previous example and all, I was not using constructor. So even if I'm not defining the constructor, if I'm not creating the constructor, which is default constructor, when this line is executed, the Java will create the default constructor, and it will assign the value of instance variable to zero. Width will be zero, height will be zero, depth will be zero. So just save this. See, even though I'm not setting any volume, the default value has been assigned for width, height and depth. So that's why I'm getting zero as the output. So that is the one point you should remember. So if you're not creating the default constructor, the Java will create its own default constructor. So this is the point. This is regarding the constructor. So this constructor called default constructor will always initialize the value to 5, 10, 3. So it is also not useful, because every box will have the same dimension. So now you want to give different values to different variables, like width should have some value, height should have some value, depth should have some value. So in that case, we can use parameterized constructor. So in the previous example, where we are using the default constructor, every box had the same values. Now I want to give different values to different variables. So what is the easy way? Means I can use parameterized constructor. So parameterized constructor is more, what it will do means it will give different values to different variables. So what I will do means, instead of this one, I will create WHD. So what I am doing means I am creating a default. So instead of default constructor, I am creating a parameterized constructor. I am creating a parameterized constructor. What this parameterized constructor is doing means it will give me different values. It will give me different values for width. I'm passing W, for height it will be H, and for depth will be D. So instead of using the common values, now the box will have different values. Now the box will have different values. So how to call this means, so this constructor will be getting their values when the object is created. Here I will pass the values I want. I want width to be 5, height to be 10, depth to be 3. So I'll pass like that. So now the object BB will have 3 values. Width will be 5, height will be 10, depth will be 3. Similarly, 10, 12, 4. Width for second object, the width will be 10, height will be 12, and depth will be 4. So in this way, I've created two objects. B1, it is having its own initial values, and BB, it is having its own initial values. So now here, the values of BB will be 5, 10, 3, meaning width is 5, height is 10, and depth is 3. Similarly for B1 also. So how do I know that? So we'll just calculate. We'll just run this program. If you run this program, by looking at the output, you will understand. I'll run this. So you can see the output will be the multiplication of 5, 10, 3, 150. BB is having 150, and 12 tens of 120 into 4, 480. So BB1 is having 480. So from this, you can see each object is initialized as specified in the object declaration. In the object declaration itself, I declared new box of 5, 10, 3. So each object got its value. So here the values 5, 10, and 3 were passed to box constructor, and 5, 10, 3 were copied to width, height, and depth. So this is the usage of parameterized constructor. So any doubts here? Any doubts with respect to parameterized constructor? Any doubts? See, for one program, we are just adding the modifications. So now the next concept is we have one. Okay. So we have one keyword called this keyword. So why this keyword will be used means sometimes the methods want to refer to the object that has invoked it. So for allowing this, Java will use this keyword. So this keyword can be used inside any method for referring to the current object. So if you're using this, means this will always refers to the object on which the method was invoked. So to understand this keyword, we need to know about the instance variable hiding. So in Java, it is illegal to declare two local variables with the same name inside the same enclosing scope. So that is like you can have local variables which will overlap with the name of the instance variable. So when this is being done, the local variable and instance variable both will have the same name. The local variable will hide the instance variable. So this means local variable will hide the instance variable. By telling these definitions, it might look confusing. So if I explain through an example, it will be better for you. So now we have a program. So now I'll just so now we have width, height, depth. So these are instance variable. So here I'm passing the variables. No, these are local variables. So these are the local variables. We are W, H, and D are the local variables. So when you are using different names, like with and W, you won't get any problem. You won't get any issues. You won't get any problem. But if I use it as width, if I use it as height, and if I use it as depth, if the function contains parameter that are local variables which are same as the instance variable. So here the width, which is a local variable, is having the same name as the instance variable, and I'm assigning width is equal to width, height is equal to height, and depth is equal to depth, meaning I'm assigning the local values to the instance variable. But the problem is here instance variable and local variable. So this is instance variable, this is local variable. So instance variable and local variable both are having the same name. So now what I'm doing is I'm assigning the instance variable is being initialized by the assigned by the local variable. So when I do this, I'll just go with one example. One example will be better. Okay. Set dimension is not needed now. I'll just remove that. Box B1 is also not needed. With one example only, we will simplify the program. So now what I did, I created a box object with values of 5, 10, and 3 to be passed to the constructor. So now width contains 5, height contains 10, and depth contains 3. So the values which are passed is 5, 10, 3. But I'm copying the width to width, height to height, and depth to depth, meaning I want to copy 5 to width, 5 to width, meaning I want 5 to be copied here, 10 to be copied here, and 3 to be copied here. And when the calculation is done, it should be 5 star 10 star 3. So constructor, I'm giving the values of width, height, and depth as 5, 10, 3. And I'm calling the volume function. When I'm calling the volume function, my output should be 5 tens of 50, 15 to 3 will be 150. But what will happen means you'll get 0 as the output. You'll get 0 as the output because the local variables are hiding the instance variable. So here this width refers to this instance variable, height refers to this instance variable, and depth refers to the instance variable. But what this local variable is doing means it is hiding the instance variable. So how to avoid this naming collusion? You have to use the keyword this. So if you're using this keyword will prevent this. See, this dot width means I'm referring to the instance variable. So this dot height means I'm referring to I'm referring to the instance variable. And if I use this dot depth, I'm referring to the instance variable. Now the naming collision is avoided. And if I run this, I'll get the output as 150. So this was the problem. So in order to overcome this problem, we are using this keyword. See, remember, when this local variable value and this value means the name is different, means don't worry. If it is width and if it is W means, sorry, if it is width and if it is W means, don't worry. Error, you need not use this keyword. But when this local variable and instance variable are having the same value, it is always recommended to use this keyword. Why? Because when the local variable is having the same name as the instance variable, the local variable will hide the instance variable. The preference will be given to the local variable, because of which it will hide the instance. The instance variable will get hidden. So if you want to use different names. If not, you can refer to the object. You can refer to the object by using this keyword, so that it will avoid any namespace collision which will occur between the instance variable and the local variable. So this is the usage of this keyword. So any doubts here? Why will we using this keyword? The same thing which I've written it in the next slide. Any doubts here? Okay, so let us proceed with the next thing. What is garbage collection? So garbage collection. See, in C++, you can allocate the objects. You can allocate the memory to the objects by using new keyword. By using the new keywords, you can allocate memory to the object, and you can remove memory, or you can deallocate those objects by using the delete keyword. So you can use new keyword for adding, like allocating the memory, and delete for removing the object from the memory. But in Java, all these things will be done. The deallocation, that is the removing of object from the memory, will be done automatically. So this technique we will call it as garbage collection. So what it is happening means, in Java, the deallocation will be done automatically. This method we will call it as garbage collection. So how it will work? How it will work means, see, when no reference to the object is made. So for an object, there is no references. So that time, we will assume that the object is no longer needed, and the memory occupied by that object can be reclaimed. So meaning to destroy that object. So garbage collections will occur during the execution of our program also. It will occur at some point of time. It will not occur simply because one or more objects doesn't need to be removed. One, and also this Java runtime implementation will take different approaches for garbage collection, which need not worry. So all these things will be taken care by the JVM. So only thing is, you should know that garbage collection means automatically the objects that are not referenced or that are no longer needed will be removed from the memory, and all these things will be taken care by JVM. So this is regarding the garbage collection. So what happens means, sometimes when the object is being removed, it needs to perform some operations. For example, like if the object is opening some file, the object has opened some file. So before that object is removed, it has to close that file. So sometimes the object will need to perform some operations before it is removed. So in that case, for example, if the object is opening some file, that object before destroying has to close that file, so that resource means the file which was opened is now closed, and that file is free now. So that you can make sure that the resources will be free before the object is destroyed. So in order to do that, Java provides a mechanism called finalization. So sometimes the object needs to perform some operation before getting removed. So this thing is taken care. This thing is taken care by the finalization method, where what it will do means, it will check whether the object is referring some resources. In that case, that resources should be freed before the object gets destroyed. So by using this finalization, you can specify the actions that will occur when the object is about to be destroyed. So if you want to add this finalizer to a class, you should define a method called finalize method. So there is a method called finalize method. So if you want to add this finalizer to a class, you should define this finalize method. So what this Java runtime system will do means the Java runtime calls that method whenever it is about to recycle the object of that class. So inside this finalize method, you should specify the actions that is to be done. So inside this finalize method, you specify the actions that is to be performed before the object gets destroyed. So this garbage collector will run periodically checking for the objects which are no longer needed, which are no longer referenced in a class. So before freeing that object, the Java runtime system will call this finalize method. And also the return type of this finalize method will be void, and it is protected. Why it is protected means to prevent the unwanted access. So to prevent unwanted access outside the class in which it is defined, it is using the specifier protected. So that's all. So this is regarding the garbage collection. So any doubts here? Any doubts regarding the garbage collection? Is this point understood? Garbage collection? Any doubts? So objects that are no longer needed will be removed automatically. So that point you can keep it in mind regarding the garbage collection. So what is the next thing which you are going to study? So the next thing is inheritance. So already I have studied this inheritance in C++. So now let us see how to implement the inheritance in Java. So this inheritance is one of the major one of the major features in object oriented programming. Why? Because it can be used for classification, hierarchical classification. You can create a class which has common characteristics, and that class can be used by another classes which needs those common characteristics, and it can add its own extra characteristics. So for example, there is a class called A. The class called A can perform the task of addition and subtraction. So when you're writing a program to perform the arithmetic calculations, so you can refer that class for the functions addition and subtraction, and you can add the multiplication and division in your own class. So like this, so common characteristics you can derive, and you can add your own features to that. So like this. So in Java, see, common characteristics will be there. You want to get those common characteristics, and you can add your own extra characteristics. So this is how the inheritance works. So in Java, a class that is inherited, we will call it as super class. For example, there is one class called A, and it has some features. So now there is one class called B, which is using the features of class A. So this is a syntax. Let's not worry about this. Now class A is known as the super class, a class which is inherited is called as the super class, and the class which does the inheriting, we will call it as subclass. So we have two terminologies: superclass, subclass. So superclass means the class that does inheriting is called as the class that is inherited is called as a superclass, and the class that does the inheriting is known as the subclass. So what this subclass will take means, so whatever variables is there, whatever functions are there in this class A, all those things will be available to class B also. And also, in addition to this class, A class for variables and functions, class B will have its own variables and functions. That's all when inheritance is done. So now, how to perform inheritance in Java? So how to perform inheritance in Java means you can relate two classes by using the extents keyword. You can create an inheritance relationship between two classes by using the extents relationship, where this is the superclass and this is your subclass. So this is the syntax. So this is the syntax to create a inheritance relationship. So now we have studied about the inheritance. Now let us check an example. To implement the inheritance. So the first thing is I'll just create a new program, file, new project. I'll give just the name as inheritance. Next, I don't want this module. So finish. So once I write like this, I would have got some folder by the name inheritance. I should add the class to that. I'll just add a class by the name. What shall I give the name? I'm creating two classes, class A, class B. So I'll just give the name as demo. I'll just give the class name as demo. So I'll just finish this. So now inheritance. Now I want to perform the inheritance. No. So first I will create a class called, A. For this class called A, I will use two variables, I, comma, j. For class called A, it contains two variables and one method void display. So void disp, what it is doing, it will just display a message, system.out.println. We can print the value of I and j here, value of I and j, which is given by I j. So I just give some space for value of I and for j also, value of I and j. So what this function is doing means, this display function, so what this value of I and j plus i, okay. So what this function is doing means, it is just displaying me the value of I and j. So this display function will see there is a class called A, that class contains two variables I and j, and it contains a function called display. The display function will just print the value of I and j. Now we will create an inheritance class. I'll create a subclass called B. How to create the inheritance relationship in Java means, first I'll create a class called B. Now, how to create the inheritance relationship means, use the keyword extends and the class which you want to create. Here I want to extend superclass. So for this class called B, I'll create one variable called k, and one function for displaying that. So void, I'll write it as display k. So what it will do means, it will just display the value of k. So I'll just copy from here some statement, value of, still here I'll copy, for let's not waste the time, value of k plus okay. So now this function is it is just displaying the value of k, and also I'll write one more function called sum function to perform the addition of i plus j plus k. to perform the addition of I plus j plus k system dot out dot println sum is equal to plus I plus j plus k. Sum is equal to I plus j plus k. So like this I'm writing. So we have two classes. Class A contains ij, class B contains k. Class A contains display method, class B contains display k sum method, I mean functions. Now from the demo class, I'll just copy this public static void main so that we can save some time. I'm writing, see, I just copied that method. So now from this public class, what I will do means I will create an object of B class. So I'll create an object of B class. BBB is equal to new B. So I've created an object of B class. So from this BB class, I can access display method. I can access display K method. And I can access sum method. Why? Because since I'm creating an inheritance, the variable ij, the function display, is available to B class also. So you can check here. So I'm creating this display function. And I'm able to access three things. So before calling the display function, I will give some values to that. So from the second class, from the B class, I can call display function. So this is in A class, and the rest of two functions, these two functions are in B class, and this sum is also is in B class. So now first I will give the values. Now I can give the values for ijk from the B object itself. B.i is equal to 5, B.j is equal to 10, and B.ijk is equal to 15. So see, these two objects are in A class, but because of inheritance, I'm able to access them. I given the values for them, and if I run this, you can see the outputs. You can see the outputs as value of I and j is 5 and 10, value of k is 15, and the sum is 30. So what you want to understand here is, even though if you're using, by using the inheritance relationship, you are able to access the variables of A class from the B class object. You have created a B class object, and from that you are accessing the A class object. Means the subclass is having access. The subclass is having access to all the elements of super class. So any doubts here? So similarly, even you can create an A class object also. You can create an A class object, but if you create an A class object, you can access only methods of A class. Like you can access ij, and you can access A class method display. So that is also possible. So any doubts here? So this I just wanted to tell. So even you can create the A class object also you can create. So but some issues will come. So now this variable is public, so you are able to access that. So I'll make one variable as private. So if I make this variable as private, So if I make this variable as private, like private integer j. So if I make this variable as private, then this variable j is not accessible outside the class. So how to know that means, see here I'm getting an error. So I'll just remove this I plus k, will write. So here, if I try to write this line, see this line, you will see an error mark because this variable j is accessible only within the class. This variable j is only accessible within the class. So if I try to run this, if I try to save and if I try to run this, I'll get an error. I'll get an error. Error exists in this project. Why? Because that variable j, it is not visible, meaning this variable j is private and it can be accessible only within the class A itself. So this is the one thing. So the subclass can access all the members of its superclass, but it cannot access the members of the superclass which is mentioned as private. So if I made a member as private in a superclass, that cannot be accessed by subclasses. So here I've declared J as the private. So since the subclass B is not able to access that J because that J is private. So you keep this point in mind. So whenever I make a function as private, I mean when variable as private, that variable is not accessible outside the class. So I'll just stop the class now. Any doubts? Any doubts?